Ross, could you just open your mind like this much? Okay? Now, wasn't there a time when the brightest minds in the world believed that the Earth was flat? And up until, like, what, 50 years ago, you all thought the atom was the smallest thing until you split it open and this, like, whole mess of crap came out. Now, are you telling me that you are so unbelievably arrogant that you can't admit that there's a teeny tiny possibility that you could be wrong about this?
There might be.
Can't believe you caved.
What?
You just abandoned your whole belief system. No, I mean, before, I didn't agree with you, but at least I respected you.
When debating with the religious, one of the most prominent mantras I receive is that science changes its mind, and so why should we trust it? It's meant as a slight on science, and it's often said as if it somehow justifies the conveyor's religious beliefs, when, of course, it doesn't. Now, in response, I tend to sing,
"Science adjusts its views based on what's observed. Faith is the denial of observations so that belief can be preserved."
And I then go on to explain why science changing its mind, or more accurately, the scientific community altering its view, is a good thing, that it's a sign of remarkable humility, and that it should increase their trust in science. But despite the countless times I've had this exchange in person, I'm yet to have a video dedicated to it. But, of course, that changes now. However, first and foremost, I'm a little behind on my monthly Patreon giveaway, and so this month has two winners. William Holes, you've won 30 Second Psychology by Christian Jarrett, and David Junge, you've won Lying by Sam Harris. Congratulations, and thank you sincerely for your support. This is Science Can't Be Trusted, Debunked. In 1687, the genius Isaac Newton published his masterwork, Principia Mathematica, and within it laid the foundations of classical mechanics. Now, I'm going to avoid getting into the details, as they're irrelevant to the crux of this video, but if you're interested in knowing more about Newton's laws, or indeed any of the subjects I reference within this video, then know that I've left links in the description to far more educated and entertaining presenters than I. Anyhow, Newton's laws ruled supreme among the scientific community for over two centuries, but then the genius Albert Einstein published his special and general theories of relativity, and in doing so proved Newton wrong. Except, of course, he didn't. That's a misconception. Einstein's theories didn't invalidate Newton's, they superseded them. They accounted for the same observations, and they accounted for observations that Newton's did not. For example, to make sense of Mercury's seemingly odd orbit, Newtonian mechanics had to assume the existence of another planet, while relativistic mechanics did not. It simply and accurately described it without such an assumption. Or as the phenomenal science communicator, Neil deGrasse Tyson, puts it,
"Einstein comes along, comes up with his theory of motion and his theory of gravity, the special and general theory of relativity. Out of those two theories, which are corrections to Newton's laws in these extreme regimes. If you're near the sun has very strong gravity. If you're moving around in that strong force of gravity, Newton's laws begin to fail. And no one knew this. And you look at Einstein's laws, and he says, Mercury's orbit will not follow Newton's laws, it'll follow this other path. Find out. And it exactly explained the deviations of Mercury. And so people say, oh, see, scientists, we thought this was right, and now we all huddle around this thing that's right. No, that is not how it works since 1600 onward. The way it works is if you have an experimentally determined result, and it's verified, and double-checked and triple-checked, that will not later be shown to be false. What you can find is a deeper understanding of the world that encloses that understanding. And that's what happened with Einstein.
And so yes, in light of relativity, scientists altered their view, or changed their mind. But what they changed was their interpretations, not their observations. Those observations are still verifiable, they're still a fact. It's not like we could use Newtonian mechanics to accurately determine the acceleration of a falling apple one day, but not the next. Science doesn't make U-turns like that. Anyhow, moving on, let's look at a much more clear-cut example of science changing its mind that's significantly more personal to us. One that changed our lives forever.
Have you watched Slender Man?
Oh, it was so good the way he just came out the tree.
Guys, I'm sorry.
Yeah, hi.
Dinosaurs had feathers. Jurassic Park was wrong. Yeah.
Indeed, let's talk about the discovery that the almighty dinosaurs, which literally mean terrible lizards, had feathers, and thus are perhaps more accurately terrible birds, or Dinopola. Evidently, our ancestors stumbled upon remains of what we now know are dinosaurs thousands of years ago, and most historians attribute such findings as the inspiration of many cultural and religious myths. But from the mid-19th century, which is when a truly scientific approach to dinosaurs began, all the way up to the late 20th century, the prevailing view was that dinosaurs are a form of squamata, or scaled reptile. You know, similar to what's depicted on the Jurassic Park franchise. Except, of course, for the velociraptors, which are the result of seriously extensive creative liberties. However, with this said, one man didn't draw the same reptilian conclusion, and that man was Thomas Henry Huxley, otherwise known as Darwin's bulldog. He, when analysing the morphology of the extraordinary fossil that is Archaeopteryx, proposed that dinosaurs are more closely related to birds. But, of course, his views were largely dismissed. That was until the late 20th century, when significant evidence emerged connecting dinosaurs with birds, such as John Ostrom's discovery of Deinonychus, and a huge influx of feathered dinosaur fossils from China. And thus, science changed its mind. Huxley was right. They once thought that dinosaurs are monstrous lizards, but they now think they're monstrous birds. Similarly, they once said that wine is good for us, but they now say it isn't. They once said that eggs increase our cholesterol, but they now say they don't. And they once said that horizontally striped clothing makes us look thin, but they now say it makes us look fat.
For ages you think, okay, vertical stripes make people look thinner. Then you say, oh, she's wearing vertical stripes, therefore she must be fatter than she looks. Therefore you start thinking, oh, she looks fatter because she's wearing vertical stripes. So suddenly horizontal stripes start making you look thinner because, oh, she must be thin, otherwise she'd never dare wear horizontal stripes. Then they go, oh, no, horizontal stripes make you look thinner. Oh, she must be fat, she's wearing horizontal stripes.
And so, such critics of science state, how can we trust science when it keeps changing its damn mind? At least the religious are consistent, they proudly boast. Yeah, I reply, consistently wrong. Pretending that Darwin didn't flatten the Garden of Eden, or that Copernicus didn't crush our geocentric ego, doesn't somehow discredit such discoveries. You see, this is one of the key differences between science and religion, and it's just one of the reasons that religion deserves none of the respect it so insists upon, while science deserves, at the very least, not to be grotesquely and incessantly misrepresented. When someone discovers a fact or theory that contradicts religion, the religious condemn, ostracize, and ban them and their work, and historically have enforced upon them imprisonment, exile, and even death. But when someone discovers a fact or theory that contradicts the scientific consensus, scientists praise, reward, and celebrate them and their work. They teach about their triumph, and in doing so inspire others to make such discoveries. The fact that scientists change their view when new discoveries are made is an overwhelming sign that they're really interested in what's true. Such honesty, such humility, should never be looked down upon, and it's about time the religious stop doing it. Now, the last thing I want to emphasise, and something that deserves a video all to itself, is that many of the examples that critics give of science changing its mind are actually not examples of science changing its mind. Rather, they're examples of ignorant journalists and media outlets publishing their biased interpretation of facts as facts themselves. But again, this warrants its own video, but at least merited a fair mention here too. Anyhow, as always, thank you kindly for the view, and an extra special thank you to my wonderful patrons and those of you who have donated via PayPal. Without your help, videos such as this wouldn't exist. And so from the bottom of my heart, thank you. And I'll leave you with one more brilliant remark from the legend that is Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Einstein's theories of motion and gravity, if you put in low speeds and low gravity in the equations, they become Newton's equations. So Newton's universe is a subset, an accurately described subset of a larger universe that Einstein has described. And even with Einstein, his equations can't take us to the center of a black hole. The singularity that's there. The singularity at the beginning of the universe. We know now that his theories fail. They blow up on the page. So we have a whole frontier of science to try to extend Einstein's laws into an even bigger regime that can then explain everything that's in our universe, not most things.